Okay, I think I have this running again. We're going to pick up my lecture here, Romantic Composers and the Republic. It says the composer's role changed radically during Beethoven's lifetime. He was seen as one of the first freelance musicians. Of course, Bach and all those guys, they wrote for weekly church services and concerts like Haydn did for the Esterházy family. But Beethoven is seen one of the first ones to work as a freelance musician. And the image as a free artist really spoke to these Romantic composers. Even Berlioz wrote to his father, "I want to leave on this earth some trace of my existence." And it became common for romantics to create extended works with no immediate prospect for making any money, just like we do today. And so they were seen as free artists by necessity, usually rather than choice, because of the French Revolution, the Napoleonic Wars, and things like that. There was no more money left for people to have paid composers in residence. And so musicians lost their jobs. Because in the Baroque period, remember I told you guys, they could find a job very easily, but now it's very hard. And Romantic composers wrote primarily for the middle class audience because the middle class has now grown and increased. And so during this time, this larger number of people, now we're going to start writing for those. And they were also in the 19th century captivated by this word, virtuosity. A virtuoso means you're the best of the best of what you do. For example, Tiger Woods playing golf or Michael Phelps swimming. And so in previous generations, of course, they wanted you to have to be able to wow me with operas and concerts and things like that. And now, if you're just the best of the best at what you do, people will pay just to come see you all by yourself. For example, Franz Liszt was a pianist and Niccolo Paganini was a violinist, and people would just come to hear them play. Clara Wieg Schumann was a pianist. Ladies were now able to be seen as virtuoso performers. We're still not thought of as great composers because that just takes too much brain power for our tiny little minds to be able to do something like write. But private music making increases in the Romantic era, and the piano was a fixture in every middle class home. Just like in the Renaissance, it was the lute, now it's the piano. And here's a strange thing that we've run into. Romantic composers come from the social class that is their main audience, which is the middle class. Berlioz was the son of a doctor, Schumann, the son of a bookseller, Mendelssohn, the son of a banker. And this is a new situation because these parents don't want these children going into something that they can't make any money at. And Berlioz was actually in med school and decided to drop out and wrote his father a letter. It says, quote, "I'm voluntarily driven toward a magnificent career. No other term can be applied to the career of an artist. And I'm not in the least headed toward damnation. This is the way I think, the way I am, and nothing in the world can change me." So these parents really did not want their children going into music as an art, because they they had no prospects for making any money at this time. Middle class parents had reason for concern because there are no job prospects. On the next page, we're going to start talking about the genre that was popular during this time, known as the art song. An art song is a composition for solo voice and piano, and the difference between somebody just singing a solo with a piano is the soloist could keep singing without the piano, it would make total sense, or vice versa. But with an art song, you have to have the two things side by side, hand in hand, for it to make sense. Trying to move myself around on the screen. Okay, thank you for, let me pause there for just a moment. So the art song is a composition that does need the piano and the voice at the same time. The two parts don't make sense without one another. And so we have things, this says, yearning inspired lost love, nature, legends, other times and places, haunted the imagination of the poets. Thus, art songs are filled with despair of unrequited love, the beauty of flowers, trees, and brooks, and supernatural happenings and folk tales, songs of joy, wit, and humor. So, this is a big genre that pops up during this time period. And at the end, it is usually summed up by a concluding piano section called a postlude. Now, a song cycle is a group of songs that are joined by text to tell a story. Poet's Love, Dieterlied by Schumann, is an example of that. It just pains me to have to say this, but R. Kelly Trapped in a Closet, if y'all know what I'm talking about, is a song cycle. If you don't, then Lord have mercy, don't waste your time. So let's talk about some composers. The career of Franz Schubert is the earliest of the Romantic art song and was like unlike any other composer before him because he never held an official position. He never was a concert pianist. He wasn't a conductor. He wasn't a virtuoso. He strictly earned his money from musical composition. He even says, "I have come into this world for no other purpose than to compose." And his full genius, again, like a lot of composers, was not recognized until years after his tragically early death. He was born in Vienna, son of a schoolmaster. And even as a child, he had astounding musical gifts. His teachers would say, if I wanted to teach him anything new, he already knew how to do it. He had a love of poetry and a love of the art song. He worked for his dad until his late teens at the school, and he hated that job. And at the age of 17, he had his first big hit, Gretchen at the Spinning Wheel, Gretchen am Spinnrad. The next year, when he was 18, he composed 143 songs, which included The Erl King, which we're going to listen to in just a second. And when he was 19, his productivity rose to his peak of 179 works. He is associated with a group of Viennese poets who led a bohemian existence. And for y'all that don't know what that means he was kind of a hippie. He often lived with his friends, it says, because he didn't have money to pay his own rent. So he would just crash at everybody's house. And he worked really fast from morning until early afternoon to turn out one piece after another, hence 179 works in a year. I mean, my gosh, that's like one every other day or less. And that way, his afternoons and evenings he could spend in the cafes, which were, coffee houses and things like that with his friends. And in the evenings, they would have parties at each other's houses where they played his music and everybody would get drunk and sing at the piano, and they called him Schubert Aid. So, kind of a hippie existence. Now, he died at the age of 1828, in 1828 at the age of only 31. And this is what the book doesn't tell you. I would tell you that he died from syphilis, but that is not the case. He actually died from seeking treatment for syphilis. And back then, the treatment for syphilis was to check yourself into this treatment facility, and they would just paint your whole body from head to toe with this concoction that, believe it or not, the main ingredient in it was mercury. And so he died actually from heavy metal poisoning from all this mercury. And along with about 600, more than 600 songs, he composed symphonies, string quartets, chamber music, etc. He was in the process of writing his un the, what we call Schubert's Unfinished Symphony when he died. And after he died, that was when people said, they thought of him as just that little guy that just wrote songs. Oh, that's just that little fellow that writes songs. Until after he's dead, and they're like, holy cow, he really was a genius. And so his genius was discovered 10 years after his death by Robert Schumann. Now, the Erl King is Erlkönch, is the elf king. And in all our folklore, we have things like we tell our children, oh, behave or the boogeyman will get you. Or, if you see the Grim Reaper, it means you're going to die. Well, in German folklore, it's the king of the elves. And if you see the king of the elves, it means it's not looking too pretty for you. And this piece of music is a piano piece because it is an art song. So you have the piano and then you have the voice. And the two parts do not make sense without each other. So with the piano part, you have this triplet figure. Da 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 da. And that represents the in your imagination, you should think of it as this galloping of this horse. And it's just racing through the night. And it's a man on horseback with his son who's racing through the night trying to get him home because he is sick. And so here is the Elf King. If I can get it to play.
Thank you.
Okay, so you can see kind of how they like the sci-fi aspect of things, and that's a really neat story. I hope you were reading along. All right, the next guy is Robert Schumann. It says, in many ways embodied musical romanticism, his works are intensely autobiographical and usually have descriptive titles, text, or programs. He has a very lyrical nature. He was born in Germany, studied law, but he rarely attended lectures, sound familiar to some of you, and devoted himself to going over to the music hall, where he wanted to become a piano virtuoso, but the goal became impossible when he developed a serious problem with his right hand. In searching for a cure, he used a mechanical gadget designed to stretch and strengthen his fingers, but neither the device nor various medical treatments alleviated the condition, and he told his mother. She was just devastated for him, but he said, don't worry about it, Mom, I can compose without it, because he was just content to be, not necessarily be a performer. But he also becomes famous as a music critic in his 20s. He founded and edited the New Journal of Music, and where he gave reviews of radical young composers such as Chopin and Berlioz. And this is where he gained a lot of fame. He met his teacher's daughter when he was studying with Wieck. Schumann met Wieck's daughter, Clara. And the two were engaged when she turned 17, because she was 9 years old when he met her and was just like, oh, that's my teacher's daughter. But by the time she was 17, they decided to get married. So there was 9 years age difference between them. So I can see where the father probably had a problem. Plus, Clara was his star pupil, and he's like, what, you're gonna, you've worked your whole life for this career, and you're fixing to head out on the greatest musical career that any woman has ever had and become a famous performer, because she was a great pianist. And what are you going to do, chuck it off for some dude? And she said, no, I'm not going to. If it's not, if I can't have him, I don't want anyone. And his father, her father was like, you know what, then it's nobody. Well, they fought bitterly for 9 years for her to be able to have the right to marry him. She even did it, took him to court, trying to sue for the right to marry Robert. And after 9 years, her father was like, fine, I guess you meant it. Just marry the dude. Just chuck it off. See if I care. But her career did continue, and she was a great pianist. But sadly, during Robert's later years, it said he suffered a mental and physical health deterioration. And in 1854, he tried to drown himself by jumping off a bridge and he failed. So he was committed to an asylum where he died 2 years later because that was just not the place to be back then, for sure, was in an asylum. They were not the helpful places that we have today. All right, the next guy is Frederic Chopin. And Chopin was the only great composer who wrote almost exclusively for the piano. And again, he was kind of a one-trick pony, but he was the best pony at the show, hence the fact that all these other people did so many things, and he only did the piano, which set him apart. His mother was Polish and his father was French, and he was brought up in Warsaw, graduated at the conservatory there. He eventually moved to Paris, where he rubbed elbows with the artistic who's who. And became friends, and where he met such writers as Victor Hugo, Balzac, Henry Heine. The painter Delacroix was a close friend of Chopin's, as well as Liszt and Berlioz. So here he is rubbing elbows and hobnobbing with the rich and famous. And he loved living a kind of a lavish lifestyle, but he hated giving concerts. So he made all of his money teaching pianos to daughters of the rich, and so he could live in luxury. He had a well-known love affair with Aurore Dudevant, who was a novelist named. Whose pen name was George Sand. And again, ladies, if a woman would have submitted something for publication, it would just have been tossed. So, hence the need for doing pen names of a man's name. He was frail and he thrived on her care and composed many of his greatest works during the years they lived together. After they separated, his health declined and he composed very little and died at only the age of 39 of tuberculosis. Now, I'm told that the reason why they broke up was because they had a dispute over something one of her boys had done. She was divorced. So she was kind of unconventional in the fact that, first of all, she was divorced, and that was just kind of unheard of back then. Second of all, she lived openly with him for all those years, which was not heard of back then either, for a woman to live with a man. And I'm here, she liked to wear pants, which was unheard of for a woman. And again, she wrote, which was unheard of for a woman. So she was very unconventional. But they got in an argument because he came down pretty hard on one of her sons about something, and she sided with the son instead of him. And he was like, okay, so that's how it's going to be. So that kind of broke them up. Now, he wrote things called nocturnes, and we get the word nocturne meaning nocturnal or night piece. It's slow and lyrical. And this nocturne in E flat major is probably one of his most famous pieces. You've heard it so many different places. It's in the movies, and a lot of my students say that it's in the movie. Hannibal in the scene in one of the weird scenes. I've never watched Hannibal, so I don't know. Now, this is an example of the word rubato that we talked about the other day, how it speeds up and then it slows down to take its time and then it rushes back ahead. So the E flat major nocturne. Okay, another famous piece of his is called his the Etude in C minor. Now, it's known as the Revolutionary Etude. Now, the Etude in C minor is wonderful, and it does something that it's called the Revolutionary Etude because it does something that most etudes do not. Now, the word etude comes from the French verb étudier. Étudier means to study. And this is a study. Whenever you do an etude, it's a study. It's a practice piece. It's like homework. Now, Chopin was frustrated that his right hand was not as talented as his left hand. And we know most piano music is written for people with right hand. Well, you lefties out there, y'all have to struggle because all the difficult part is usually in the right hand, and then the left hand just gets the chords. Well, he said, there's only the only reason my left hand is not as capable as my right hand is because I just don't practice it enough. And so he wrote this study, this etude, to force him to practice his left hand. The right hand, even as a horrible pianist as I am, I can even play the right hand. The left hand is nothing but scales and runs for the whole entire piece. So this is his revolutionary etude in C minor.
Thank you.
Okay, it continues on from there and just repeats, and it just gets more difficult as it goes. Our next composer is Franz Liszt. Now, it's hard in our older book for me to say that he was a magnetic, handsome man, that he was, but he was very revolutionary. He was a showman, he was irresistible to women, and during the 1840s, he performed superhuman feats on the piano, overwhelming the public. Chopin himself even said when he went to a concert, Liszt was playing Chopin's music on the concert that day. And excuse me, just one second. Okay, I'm back. So Chopin even attended a concert that Liszt was playing, and Liszt was playing Chopin's music. And what a compliment. Even Chopin said, "Wow, I wish I could play my music like that." And Brahms even said, "Whoever has not heard Liszt cannot speak of piano playing." Translation: if you haven't heard this kid play, then you just don't know what you're talking about. He was born in Hungary. His father was the administrator for the Esterházys that Haydn had worked for. At 11, he studied in Vienna, where he met Schubert and Beethoven. During his teens and 20s, he lived in Paris. When he was 19, he was already an acclaimed, brilliant pianist. But one night, he went to a concert with the great violinist Paganini. Now, Paganini was just an amazing violinist, and people just could swear that there's no way anybody could do the things that he does. Your book here says they claimed he was in league with the devil. I say it this way. It's kind of like the song, "The Devil Went Down to Georgia Looking for a Soul to Steal." With Liszt, it was whispered behind his back that the only reason he was as amazing as he was because he had sold his soul to the devil in exchange for his abilities. And I guess he kind of even fed that persona a little bit, because some nights after concerts, he would even go down to the cemetery and to, quote, pay homage. And he would sit and play his concert again in the cemetery, and people would follow him to the cemetery to hear him play. So you know how these famous people are. They feed the hype, and he was no different. Well, after Liszt heard him perform, he was in such awe of Paganini's abilities. He said, "You know what? Right now, I am one of the greatest pianists in the world. But the problem with that sentence is 'one of.' I'm not going to rest until I'm the Paganini of the piano. I want to be the greatest pianist in the world." So he withdrew for a couple of years from the concert stage and did nothing but 8 to 12 hours a day but practice. And after this couple of year time period, when he emerged, he was probably the greatest pianist of his time. And he would even say, with my piano, he would make transcriptions of violin pieces and symphonies and things. He says, "My piano is my very self. A man's 10 fingers had the power to reproduce harmonies which are created by hundreds of performers." Once, after an orchestral performance of his movement of Berlioz's Fantastic Symphony, he played his own arrangement and made a more powerful effect than the entire orchestra. What he said was, "You know what? It takes you hundreds of people on the stage to achieve this, and just me and my piano and my two hands, I can make it even sound even better than that." But he didn't want to go down. It's like, "I just don't want to go down as like this piano dude. You know what? I think I'm going to compose." So he sat down for a few years and made himself be a composer. And guess what? He was great at it. Well, then after a few years after that, he's like, "Well, I don't want to just compose. You know, I want to conduct." So he got a gig as a conductor, and he was great. Well, then on top of that, he was just this really nice person that everyone liked. And he says, "You know what? Look at these poor kids over here. You know, why is it only the rich kids get to take lessons? We got these children over here that have a lot of talent, and nobody's doing anything with them because they can't afford the lessons." He said, "You know what? I'm going to teach. And if you have enough money, pay me. If you don't pay me. I don't care. If you have enough talent, I will teach you whether you can pay me or not." And guess what? He was a great teacher. So just because you can perform doesn't mean you can compose. Just because you can compose does not mean that you can conduct. Just because you can conduct does not mean that you can teach, and vice versa. But he could do all of it and did all of it very well. And he had a very long career. And he is also thought to be the one that created this thing called a symphonic poem or a tone poem, which is a one movement orchestral composition based to some extent on a literary or pictorial idea. For example, there's this piece of music that you're all probably familiar with, Mickey Mouse, his most iconic thing, wearing the blue sorcerer's hat, the sorcerer's apprentice. Dun, dun. Dun, 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 dun. That is actually a symphonic poem. It was written a poem by Paul Dukas, and then well, the poem was written by Gautier. Then Dukas wrote the music to go along with it, and then several years later, Walt Disney said, "Hey, Mickey Mouse can do that," and set it to a cartoon. But it started off as a poem that got set to music. The next guy is Felix Mendelssohn. Mendelssohn does not fit the starving artist mode. Actually, his parents were a wealthy, distinguished Jewish family, even though he was raised Protestant. By the age of 9, he was a brilliant pianist. By 13, he had written symphonies, concertos, sonatas, and vocal works. And as a teenager, performed at home with his, get this, his own private orchestra. He was so great, his parents hired him his own orchestra where he could perform for the artistic elite of Berlin, where his parents had settled. And when he was 20, he conducted Bach's St. Matthew's Passion in its first performance since Bach had died. And this concert rekindled the interest of Bach's music and earned Mendelssohn an international reputation. He performed as a pianist and an organist, and he was a favorite of Queen Victoria. As a matter of fact, his piece that he wrote right off the block, where he gained his fame and fortune at 17, was when he wrote Midsummer Night's Dream. And the piece of music that is played in weddings. Dun 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 dun. That is actually from Mendelssohn's Midsummer Night's Dream. And of course, once the Queen has something like that done at her wedding, of course, everybody wants that. Now, Mendelssohn, sadly, he lived a conventional life. He was married and had, let's see, four children. I was going to say three, but four children. But the constant travel and exhausting work sapped his strength, and he died after a stroke at only 38. So that was extremely young to die from a stroke. I mean, these people just died young. As you can see, being a musician is a stressful job. Let's see. We'll jump over here to page 235 with program music. Program music, we said, gives a pictorial image or idea based upon like a story, poem, or idea. So it gives you a mental picture to have program music. The opposite of program music is absolute music. Music written for just to be music, non-programmatic music. So, for example, a fugue or a rondo or Beethoven Symphony Number 5. None of these titles or music are supposed to make you have this kind of a story in your head. They're just music to be music. Whereas program music tells a story like Romeo and Juliet or the Nutcracker Suite. So a program symphony tells a story, but it's in one move. It's in a symphonic movement with five movements, like Berlioz Symphony Fantastique has five movements, versus the program or symphony, excuse me, tone poem or symphonic poem is just, it tells a story, but it's only one long song. It's not divided into movements the way a program symphony is. And then a concert overture has one movement, usually in sonata form. It's not any longer used to introduce a show. It's just a piece written in sonata form. Incidental music is music to be performed during and before a play. It's incidental to the stage drama, kind of like if you watch a movie, there's music always in the background. You just don't know that it's there. You don't pay any attention to it. But you would notice if it wasn't there because it would be like something's really missing here. So incidental music is always around us. We just don't pay much attention to it. Now, Berlioz is a freaky, freaky dude. He's one of my favorites. Now, Berlioz was the son of a doctor, and he was actually in med school. But your book says he was, quote unquote, horrified by the dissecting lab. That means he was taking gross anatomy, and for those of y'all that don't know what gross anatomy is, when you're going to be a surgeon or a doctor, you have to take gross anatomy, which is where they dissect a cadaver so that they can un actually understand how the body works. And I'm trying to find this piece of music for us. I'm sorry. So he was doing okay in med school until he got to that, and he was like, no way, I cannot do this. So he dropped out. And he started hanging out at the Shakespearean theater. And this is where he falls in love with this Shakespearean actress in the theater. Her name was Harriet Smithson. Now, girls, I'm just going to tell you, this is where he gets weird. He's like, hey, Harriet, you want to go out? And she's like, oh, no, I don't think so. So he starts going to all her shows and watching everything that she's in and sending her love letters and sending her flowers and just wooing her. And she keeps saying no. So I'm just saying he was a stalker. Stalker for sure. But one night, she decides to go to see his concert. Now, he only had about 1,200 faithful people that bought tickets and was not enough to support him in his concert. So he became a brilliant writer as well and became a critic. And so he would supplement these concerts with his money that he made himself. Now, Again, Symphony Fantastic, the Fantastic Symphony was, oh gosh, this is the wrong one. I'm sorry. Here's the one that I want. Okay, so it's five movements. And does life imitate art? Now, a lot of people say he had a drug problem, that he took hallucinogenic drugs. They say that he was taking this drug called laudanum, which his doctor father would have recognized that he had an addiction had his father not also been addicted to laudanum. But this is a program symphony. He handed the program notes to you on the way in the door. And so, does life imitate art? Now, her friend goes, "Hey, Harriet, I hear that dude that likes you barely has given a concert. Do you want to go?" And she's like, "Well, I guess." So they're handed this concert coming in. Now, girls, I'm just going to say, if somebody handed me this and I read it later, she goes, "You know what? Oh, I think this is about me." And she starts going out with him and they get married. No, I'm just going to tell you, if I read this, it'd be, "Girl, I think this is about me. We need to get a restraining order. This guy's crazy." Because this is the story. A young musician of extraordinary sensibility and abundant imagination, in the depths of despair because of hopeless love, has poisoned himself with opium. The drug is too feeble to kill him, but plunges him into a heavy sleep accompanied by weird visions. His sensations, emotions, and memories as they pass through his affected mind are transformed into musical images and ideas. The beloved one herself becomes to him a melody, a recurrent theme that haunts him continually. And so this melody that you keep hearing is her, and that's called the idée fixe. That is French for fixed idea. So every time you hear this melody, you're supposed to know that she has entered the scene. Now, the first movement is called Reveries and Passions. He dreams they have first met, and it's, oh, love at first sight, and there's just great. Until all of a sudden she does something that makes him a little jealous. And so the evil green jealousy monster rears its head. Well, she gets offended. She goes, I don't think so. Well, he immediately becomes contrite and says, oh, please take me back. It'll never happen again. Now, girls, guys, too, if somebody ever says this, the answer is no. You just need to stay away from them. But she goes, well, okay, if you promise it'll never happen again. Well, then the second movement is called a ball. And he dreams he has taken her to a party, to a ball, and they're dancing and they're having a waltz and they're having a grand time until all of a sudden she danced with somebody else. Well, he gets angry because she's danced with somebody else. So the end of the song ends on this ominous tone, which leads us to the third movement, which is called Scenes in a Country. And it is reminiscent of like two shepherds on opposing hillsides playing melodies back and forth to each other. And it signifies like the two of them talking to each other. So this one calls out and then this one responds. And this one calls out and this one responds. Well, then this one calls out and she kind of responds. Then this one calls out more frantic and this one barely responds. Until in the very end, this one is calling and this one is not answering at all. And so that is her turning her back on him saying, "You know what, dude, we're through." Now, it is at this point, ladies, that I would have gotten a restraining order because the fourth movement is called March to the Scaffold. And this is what it says. He dreams he has murdered his beloved. I'm sorry, I don't want to be with nobody dreaming they've murdered me. He has been condemned to death and is being led to the scaffold. The procession moves forward to the sound of a march that is somber and fierce, now brilliant and solemn, in which the muffled footsteps, the sounds of heavy steps, give way without transition to the noisiest outburst. At the end, the idée fixe, the fixed idea, returns for a moment like a last thought of love interrupted by the death blow. Now, in this piece of music, when it starts off, it's the drums, like he's being led out to the scaffold, because the scaffold is where they did the execution with the guillotine. You know, a scaffold is a platform. So you hear him being led out, going down the street, and you start hearing these melodies, so like the bassoon goes, bop, 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 bop. And this signifies people talking and getting really excited, because, you know, back then, public executions were public entertainment. And the crowd takes on this kind of a jovial kind of sound, and then it gets bigger and bigger until they finally get to the execution site, and it gets really angry sounding. And they start shouting at each other, and the music goes, da, 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 back and forth, really, really loud. Well, then, if you listen very carefully, all of a sudden, he leans over and he puts his head in the guillotine and it goes boom, bloop, bloop. And that signifies his head being chopped off and landing in the basket. Then it goes ta-da, and everybody starts applauding at the end. So this is March to the Scaffold. Thank you. crowd's starting to grow a little bit and everybody's chatting, having a really good time. Fake. If you listen carefully, the head gets chopped off. And boom, 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 boom. There went his head. Now everybody's applauding. So that was Berlioz. And the last movement is called Dream of a Witch's Sabbath. And it says, he sees himself at a witch's Sabbath in the midst of a hideous crowd of ghouls, sorcerers, and monsters of every description united for his funeral. Strange noises, groans, shrieks of laughter, distant cries, which other cries seem to answer. The melody of the loved one is heard, but it's lost its character of nobleness and timidity. It is no more than a dance tune, ignoble, trivial, and grotesque. It is she that comes to the Sabbath. A howl of joy greets her arrival. She participates in the diabolical orgy. The funeral knell, the burlesque of the Dies Irae, the witch's dance, and the Dies Irae are combined. Now, Dies Irae is part of a funeral mass. So he really caught heck from people after this one. How dare you take something sacred like a mass and put it in something as diabolical as this? And so he really caught a lot of flack over that. Okay, so that will end our lecture notes for today. And I will pick up with nationalism in class tomorrow.